your pain is your crowning. If you worship God with it. When I see you bitter about what you've gone through, I say it's because you're blind. You don't know that you went through that to become who you are. And the reason who you are hasn't manifested is because you're still bitter about what you went through. But when you start worshiping God, that in spite of what you went through, you are still here in your right mind. You still got a shout. God routed you to resurrection. He's taking chains off of you. He took drugs from you. He took harlotry from you. Hey, what you talking about? You have a reason. So now watch. In the first text, we read about Cleopas. When you go to the book of John, you will see why Jesus called him a fool. He ran when the Lord was being crucified. But his wife was one of those that stayed and watched the whole thing. The Bible tells you Mary, the wife of Cleopas. He not only ran, he left town. That reminds me of church folks. They say when a church starts doing a building program, people start visiting other churches. Then when you finish, they come back for the grand opening. I'm talking about how we built it. So Cleopas ran. And now he's tipping out of town. So he said, and Jesus, you see, that's what I love about him. He comes to find you. It don't matter where you've gone, but he'll come and find you. Eh? That's why you could be in Las Vegas. He'll call you in service.
Hallelujah.
I came to church one morning, and I started looking for one of our members. And I called her up and said, where are you? She said, I've been in this church for years. I've never missed church. This is the first time I missed church, and you're looking for me. I said, well, he called you out. I said, where are you? She said, I'm in New Orleans. I said, see, come on back. I know what you're over there doing. But come on back. Come on back. He came to find you. He got your name. He got your number. He got your social security number. He knows, even if there are two of you sitting side by side, he knows which Mary is which Mary. He's calling. We might have the same name, but we are not the same. Now watch. So everybody were traumatized and they're locked up in the room. But that's when you begin to discover who is who. So Mary Magdalene. He freed me of seven devils. It's enough. It's enough of this chicken. I'm going to come out of this room. I'm going to go find him. Amen. Who saved me. Amen. I don't understand his death. I never thought anybody could overcome him. But I'm going to go meet him. The least I can do is to anoint his body and honor him in his death. And she left that house. And as soon as she made her move, the other Marys followed. And they started heading
Amen.
To that grave, unafraid of the Romans.
Amen.
I want you to hear my heart and the things the Holy Spirit is showing me to show to you. Most of us Americans would have said, what's the point in going? The soldiers are there. We can't move that stone. How are we going to do that? But they went anyway. That's what Paul said. He said, the love of Christ constrains us. We have every reason to chicken out. It's not convenient. It's difficult. But something in me keeps beckoning me. You belong to higher ground. Go looking for Jesus. Pray longer. Read longer. Fast longer. He's around the corner. You're going to reach him.
Amen. Hallelujah.
They ignored all those inhibitions that Satan would have raised up in their mind. And they went anyway.
Amen. Amen.
The book of Luke reports that when they got there, the angel said to them, "Why are you looking for the living among the dead?" It's amazing what realm your unbelief will put you in. And you believe you're doing the right thing, but you don't know you're so wrong. You're in left field.
Amen.
He said, "The man you came to anoint has already risen. So are you looking for him among the dead?" But they went. The first thing you need to ask yourself is, if you were there, would you have gone? In the opportunities God is giving to all of us to prove ourselves, would you still get up and go? Would you stand for him? In this secular humanist America, every time I see the chaos in California and in New York, and all these places liberals are doing their experiment, I say, God is allowing these things so America will come to her senses.
Amen.
I was so excited early this morning when I was waiting on the Lord for this service, and I told him, "Lord, I just want to have a joyful resurrection celebration. I just don't want to have another service. I want joy, laughter, celebration, a victory. Hallelujah." And he said something to me that I am so excited about. He said, "There'll be earthquakes." He wasn't talking about physical earthquakes. They put Jesus in that tomb. They sealed it with this massive stone. They put Caesar's seal on it. And they put soldiers there. No human being can get through. But God sent an angel of light. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
You mark my words. This same angel is returning to the earth.
Amen.
God said there will be earthquakes. Watch you, Nigerians. There will be earthquakes in Nigeria.
Amen.
Okay, you don't understand what I'm telling you. They have it all sealed up. They have it all done. They believe you can win it. But there will be an earthquake. The angel of the Lord will shake things loose. There'll be a shaking in America.
Yeah.
He said, "The keepers were dead men. When man sees something greater than him, I told you, God said to me these last days, it will be a glory move, not a talk. God said, there'll be earthquakes. Suddenly, what man has sold up and believes is impossible for you to change it." So there will be angelic releases all across the earth. Hallelujah. God is going to sink the strategies of man. God is going to sink the bondage. God is going to sink the witchcraft. God is going to sink the politics. Anything contrary. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
This is one thing I love. Come on, I need an usher. Run. Okay, I'm over there. Grab me one chair. One chair right there. Quick, quick, quick. He said, this is what I love about it. He said that the angel of the Lord came and shook up the place. Huh? Come on, put it up where they will see me. They're sitting there. Now he put it on the edge, so he want me to fall over. He said, the angel of the Lord rolled the stone away. And he sat on it. He sat on it to make a point. This is the best you can do. But I have power to roll it out and sit on it. To show you that I am God.
Yeah.
earthquakes, tremors. It doesn't discourage me that people are praying but don't believe. Because the church prayed for Peter and didn't believe.
Amen.
Until Peter came to the door and they wouldn't open the door. And Rhoda came and said, "Hey, Peter is at the door." The people that have been praying said, "No, you crazy." They said, it must be his angel. When did you start seeing angels?
Hallelujah.
Must be his ghost. So it doesn't bother me that the church is praying and don't believe. What makes us not believe? Because you're praying and looking at what is happening. And you think we are helpless. But that's the power of faith. Faith ignores what Satan is doing and keeps saying what God is saying. If a nation can be saved in one day, then your nation is included. Why are you people that have been praying believe that, oh, it's inevitable? Do you know how inevitable it was? On that resurrection morning? For Jesus to come out of that grave? And I remember years ago in one of these Easter services that God said to me, the stone was rolled away. Not for Jesus to come out. The stone was rolled away for you to know that he rose. He don't need the stone rolled away. He will get out of it and leave it intact. And then when you go open it, where you go? Said the disciples were all in the room. The doors were locked. And he showed up and stood in the middle of them. He said, "Peace be unto you." A resurrected man don't need keys. See, some of you will grow to understand resurrection.
Amen.
Eh? You go to a place where they say there's no road. He makes a road for you.
Amen.
You walk right through it.
Amen.
Remember that in Babylon, that all the Jews bowed to Nebuchadnezzar's image.
Mm-hmm.
Only three boys refused. Those are the three boys that brought Jesus to earth.
Amen.
And Nebuchadnezzar, the heathen king, could recognize Jesus. He said, "Didn't we put three in the fire? But the fourth man." Ooh, hallelujah. I say there's a fourth man. There's a fourth man in every fire. He's in this room this morning. He's in this room now. Hallelujah. Alive this morning.
Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
And I'm celebrating his word that he will send us earthquakes everywhere. Man has sealed everything and he's so sure that he got it done. Hallelujah. No matter what it takes, God will get it done. God will get it done. What did Paul say? He said, "For me to live is Christ, but to die is gain." If when life calls for faith, you play chicken, then you go into slavery. But the one I'm serving said, "Son, even if you're limping on one leg,
come on now.
Even in your limp, you are higher than all devils. I don't care what the names of the devils are, but he who called me say you're higher than all of them." Hallelujah. Watch, watch. The angel said to the women, "I know who you're looking for. I know you are looking for Jesus." That's the question God gave me years ago. And this morning he gave it back to me. He said, "Ask the people, who are you looking for? When you came to church, what are you looking for? Because you may have come to church to get all your stuff worked out, but you didn't come for Jesus."
Amen.
He said, "You women, I know why you came out here. You came looking for him who loves you, who delivered you, who died for you. He's resurrected! He said, go and tell his disciples. See, that's why I preach encouragement in all my messages. Even though they're chickened out and they're locked up in the room, he said, go tell them. The victory still belongs to them.
Amen.
Come on out! Come on out. He said, I'm going before you into Galilee, but I ain't coming into your locked up place. You have to go meet me where I said for you to meet me.
Amen.
He said it to them before he died. He said, when I'm risen again, I will go before you into Galilee. I wonder why he chose Galilee. He said, but head on over there. That's where I'm going to meet you. And he said, the women took off, trying to go tell the disciples. And Jesus met them. And he says something I want every one of you to take with you this afternoon, because I keep saying morning, but it's afternoon. Jesus met them and said, all hail. You may read past it and don't understand what he's saying. He's telling you, I have paid the price. I humbled myself. I was mistreated, abused, spit on. I've gone through hell and went to hell. But now I'm risen again. And there are no more options left for any devil, for any rebel, any power. It is all hail. Everybody must worship. Everybody must bow down. Every demon must submit. Every power is defeated. Hallelujah. All hail. Come on, most of you grew up in Baptist churches. You remember that song? All hail the power of Jesus' name. Let angels prostrate fall. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord.
Hallelujah. Yeah. All hail King Jesus. Go. Hallelujah.
Yeah, the Bible mentioned the other one. All hail King Jesus. All hail Emmanuel. King of kings, Lord of lords, bright morning star. And for eternity, I'm going to praise him. And forevermore, I will reign with him. Hallelujah. Jesus said, all hail. Nothing. There's nothing to negotiate. It's only among men that we have religious debates, arguments, which God is the right one. Saw this report and they caught this suicide bomber before he detonated his bomb. And he had all these bombs to his chest. And then over his thing here, he put a metal plate. And they were asking him, why did you put a metal plate down here? He said he was protecting his stuff for the seven virgins he would get. Can you believe how ignorant? So you think that you can blow all your body into pieces and keep your thing? Where is he going to get the blood to work with? Hey, hey. You're going to get seven virgins in paradise? And you can't handle one here, you need Viagra. Yeah, talking tongues. 1st of all, even the virgins will kill you over there because none of them are going to be watching you with the other one and waiting for their turn. Yep, right. They'll be telling you, we need to look, choose one of us. Amen. And that's all you're going to get. Is it not the same women? Amen. They haven't changed. They don't plan to change. Particularly the American ones. I know them all. I've been here 40 years. Yeah. They be smiling and all of that. But look like you're interested in another woman. She will talk about her like she's a devil from hell. Not even a human being. Watch out and run it. Yeah. Are you going to handle seven in paradise? I said, what foolishness. But what's the joy of a resurrected life that when I cross over, I won't be dealing with all this mess? Who cares? Who will be sleeping with who? You are in the presence of Almighty God. Life everlasting, glory, joy eternal. You think you're gonna need sex? You are.
Hallelujah. Glory to God.
You will have the ultimate orgasm in the presence of God. Satisfied.
Glory. Hallelujah.
Beloved, resurrection is glorious. I know that you and I are constantly besieged by lust, which is Satan's imitation. Glory is exhilarating. Glory is powerful. Living in the presence of God, eternally, blissfully, peacefully, joyfully, and gloriously. Amen. That's what resurrection is all about. Resurrection is God's greatest affront to Satan, to death, to hell, and the grave. So much so that the Bible declares that if the Lord Jesus did not rise from the dead, we are all yet in our sins. Nobody's saved. You are saved because of resurrection. When he came out of that grave, that's the miracle that makes your dead spirit man come alive. And we say you are born again. That is what you experience. You have to know that resurrection is real. We are not celebrating an empty ritual, some holiday. Mm-mm. This is more powerful. I know every thing God has given us that we're celebrating has this unique place. I was going to say that this is more important than Christmas, but then without Christmas, you're not going to get to resurrection. He had to be born first. So they're all important. But him dying for us is the ultimate fulfillment of the mission. Him rising from the dead is the ultimate triumph over Satan. That's why we receive the Lord's Supper every Sunday. He said, for as often as you drink, eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death until he comes. We are letting them know you lost. You bit the bait. You were defeated. You were destroyed. And you don't have a chance to come back. No. The Bible says that Jesus was made a curse for me. And the Lord said to me, and there is no way you can unmake him. He became my curse. So Except I don't believe that he became my curse. That's the only way the curse will transfer. No, he became my curse. And so it must end with me. And those coming after me will live curse-free. This ministry is graced with a curse-breaking anointing, particularly the generational curses. And I'm reversing everyone in my family. I'm reclaiming every lost inheritance. I'm decreeing that Jesus Christ will rule and reign in my village that has been controlled by these demonic people for generations. From the days of my grandfather to my father to my siblings and I. And finally, we have them on the run by the grace of God. We've put the marker down by the glory. And in the name of the Lord Jesus, they all must bow. Amen. Are you ready for resurrection? Then put your seat down. All the avenues for you to do it are there in front of you. Are you ready for resurrection? Make a commitment. Come to church. Join it. Are you ready for resurrection? Call that prayer line. Let them agree with you in prayer. A miracle will take place. You give God praise and thank him for resurrection. Thank you, Lord, for resurrection in Jesus' name. He is risen. God bless you. We love you.